welcome, Ms. Treudel. We are very interested in your talk.
Thank you very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear organizers. I was very happy to be invited here to this Sunday morning special session. And my speciality, as you said, is arteriogenesis and its basic research. I'm not a medical doctor. And I would like to separate my talk into two main topics, physiological arteriogenesis. And in the second part, I would like to show you our AV, arteriovenous shunt animal models, which we use to explore the molecular mechanisms of vascular remodeling. So as you already know, probably, there is a physiological process which we call arteriogenesis, when here in the angiography of a human patient, a main artery is occluded, then these collateral vessels develop. It's actually a beneficial remodeling of collateral arteries. They are pre-existing, and as soon as they are needed, they start to grow, and then they can bypass the arterial occlusion. When we model this in animal models, we ligate. We ligate here the femoral artery in the hind limb of an animal distal to the feeder artery of the collateral artery, so that the blood flow is directed into the collaterals, and this increased blood flow leads to increased fluid shear stress, and these collaterals start to grow. When we then harvest the adductor muscle, which contains the collateral arteries, we can see that these pre-existing collaterals here, before ligation, start to grow. They increase in diameter, the lumen is increased, and also the vessel wall thickness is increased. What we can also observe is that macrophages accumulate around the vessel. Here in green is the cross-section of collateral vessels, and the white and red cells are stained for different subtypes of macrophages. And in addition, we can also observe that these vascular cells are proliferating. So what you can here see stained in green are proliferating endothelial cells and smooth muscle cells. And this is actually the growth process. These collaterals do not vasodilate, but they really, that's a really growth process. So the cellular mechanisms or the cellular events, so to say, are quite good known in the meantime. Due to the fluid shear stress, which is exerted to the endothelium is activated, it expresses adhesion molecules, these monocytes adhere to the endothelium. The endothelial layer gets gets leakage, and these monocytes can transmigrate through the collateral wall. They differentiate into macrophages. They attract more macrophages, which then can provide the space for the outward growth. And then these endothelial cells, as I said, proliferate, as well as the smooth muscle cells, and the collateral growth process takes place. So when we want to investigate the reperfusion recovery after this ligation of the femoral artery, we can do so by laser speckle imaging. So when we ligate the femoral artery, or let's say before ligation, both hind limbs are perfused at the same way, of course, but directly after surgery, we see only maybe 10 to 20% perfusion of the operated leg. Within 14 days, these mice are capable to develop these collaterals, and they are able to reach 80% recovery of perfusion in their hind limb, and this can be measured and calculated and depicted here as a diagram. Actually, as I said, in mice are able to compensate for this ligation, but bigger animals and human patients are unfortunately not. And that's why the therapeutic goal is to promote and accelerate this process. and finally reach a complete compensation. We are also interested to identify responders and non-responders, for example, of exercise training in patients, but this is, will not be my focus today. And the accelerated compensation is especially important also in heart disease, of course, because we here also have collateral arteries in the coronary circulation, but this needs even more accelerated compensation. Yeah, as I said, the cellular events are quite good understood so far, but what is still under investigation is how the mechanical stimulus is translated into a growth response. So more in detail, it is not known so far what exactly how exactly the endothelial cells sense these fluid shear stress, then transduce the signal into the to the adjacent smooth muscle cells, and why then the initiation of the remodeling takes place. And what we thought is the problem, that this process is not really complete, is due to this equation here, that as you probably know, the fluid shear stress is the frictional force per area of this of the blood, which is exerted on the vessel wall, and this is dependent on viscosity and velocity, but it's inversely related to the radius of the vessel, which means that as soon as the collaterals start to grow, the radius is increased and the initial trigger is decreased. So, together with the vascular surgeons in Frankfurt University, we developed a model where we can maximize this stimulus of fluid shear stress. And this looks like this. We ligate the femoral artery, as this is shown here in the diagram. But in addition, distal to the ligation, we create an arterial venous shunt surgically. We connect the artery to the accompanying vein. The blood flow, again, is directed into the collaterals and is then drained into the venous system due to the pressure differences. And this leads then to a highly increased and chronically elevated fluid shear stress. And these are some pictures of the surgical intervention in rats, which is actually the smallest animal where we can apply this arteriovenous shunt surgery. This operation then had a big impact on the collateral growth. These are angiographies of the rabbit hind limb. As you can see here, 4 weeks after simple ligature without this IV shunt treatment, we have a number of small collaterals which are recruited. But after 4 weeks of shunt treatment, we have this dramatically increased recruitment of collateral arteries. They seem to be more in number and more in or increased in size. We can also measure the collateral conductance of these arteries. In the first bar, you see the non-ligated femoral artery, which we consider as 100% of conductance. With a control simple ligature, these collateral arteries are only capable to reach 50% of the non-ligated artery. But after 1 week of shunt treatment, we can already achieve 100% of the non-ligated artery, and this is even overcompensated, this process, due to the shunt treatment. After 4 weeks, we see double as much conductance as a non-ligated artery. So we have shown that with this model, with this highly increased and permanent fluid shear stress, we can reach a full compensation, but of course this is not a therapeutic option. But it allowed us to collect the tissue, the fluid shear stress stimulated tissue, and look for the molecular mechanisms. And in different studies, we have investigated mRNA proteins, and our latest study is focused on microRNAs. And therefore, first a quick introduction in microRNAs. These are short, single-stranded molecules, RNA molecules, and they target mRNA. They are not translated into proteins, but they rather repress translation of proteins. And some of them are known to be fluid shear stress regulated. And that's why we ask, maybe there are fluid shear stress induced microRNAs of functional impact during arteriogenesis. So we used rats again and treated those rats with a V shunt and collected the collateral tissue of the shunt-treated as well as of the sham-treated without this increased shear stress and found several differentially expressed microRNAs as depicted here. We then localized these microRNAs in the vessel wall as it is shown in the collateral cross-sections here. They are, these microRNAs are stained in blue and we can see that they are specifically expressed in the collaterals. When we then want to investigate if they have any functional impact on this collateral growth, we can locally block these with so-called anti-mirs. So they block these microRNAs and they cannot work anymore. And what we observed then, this was done in a mouse model. After 3 days already, these mice were not able to survive. They showed severe necrosis after this femoral artery ligation. And this is also shown here. All mice in this group of the anti-mir 143 group died, and this experiment had to be stopped. So we know from this experiment, we know that this microRNA 143 has really a functional effect or it has functional importance during collateral growth, but we still don't know how the fluid shear stress, which was initially our starting point, gives the signal to the expression of this microRNA. And therefore, we used a cell culture model. We used endothelial cells and cultured these endothelial cells either under static or under flow conditions. And there we found that these endothelial cells express TGF-beta on a higher level under flow conditions, and they even secrete these TGF. And when we then put this conditioned medium of these endothelial cells on smooth muscle cells, we can see that under flow conditions, this microRNA is higher expressed as with a medium under static conditions, which gave us the idea that this TGF-beta is the signaling molecule which induces the microRNA expression. And this could be further confirmed when we block the TGF-beta receptor in the cell culture model. This process can be reversed. So we now know then that this fluid shear stress, which is exerted on the endothelial cells, induces TGF-beta expression and secretion, and this microRNA 143, which is important for arteriogenesis, is then upregulated. So in summary, we found with our model that the shear stress is the modeling force in arteriogenesis, and this microRNA 143 seems to be a central factor. And what I see as a translational perspective is that we can interfere with or control the vascular remodeling maybe by targeting this microRNA 143. And I assume that the mechanisms which might be important in pathological fluid shear stress dependent vascular growth might be similar. And with that, I would like to thank my collaborators from Gießen, Frankfurt, and Bad Nauheim, and I thank you for your attention.